It is a joy to be back home.
The last church was Main Street United Methodist Church in Abbeville. And if you would go there this morning, do an 11 o'clock service and ask those members, you remember that preacher Randy Taylor? Now, where was he from? Well, the answer would be quick. He's from Red Bank, South Carolina. Because I am a product of this church. And it's wonderful to stand here this morning and see so many familiar faces. It's a joy to see much of my family, and as I told the choir, I think they must be gluttons for punishment because they hear me all the time when they come again this morning. But it's also wonderful this morning to stand here and see new faces. To see new faces, people I don't know. Because that means that Red Bank United Methodist Church is still making disciples for Jesus Christ. And that's what it's all about, folks. That's what it's all about. Touching hearts and souls and lives of Jesus Christ so that all may know the love of God that we find in Christ Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And you're still doing that. And that makes me happy. That brings joy when I see all of these new faces and to know that this church is still making disciples, still out there touching hearts and lives for Jesus Christ. I'm a light that was touched in this church. By people that love Jesus. What greater joy can we have than to know Jesus Christ? Sir, we would see Jesus is what the little sign here says. That's my prayer this morning, that we would see Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit, that it may come. Lead us to see and touch and be blessed and to worship and glorify and praise and honor our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I feel like I must say a word of explanation. I know that the liturgical color is green and I've got on blue, and there's a simple explanation. This little saying, may God hold you in palm of your hand, that's my signature benediction that I've used in my ministry. And on my last Sunday at Main Street, a lady made this stole and gave it to me, and I wore it that last Sunday at Main Street. Well, I wear it now because, folks, when you move, guess what? You pack things up. And then when you get to where you're going to live, guess what? You can't find half of what you want. This is the only stole I got, so you got it this morning, okay? You know, if I don't read scripture, I'll ramble on because there's just too many memories. Too many memories flooding my mind this morning. And, you know, I know that a big part of homecoming is eating. You know, that's what we Methodists do, eating pretty well. We do pretty well. So that we can get to the eating part, we better read scripture first, okay? And then have a little bit of Word of God. If you have your Bibles, I think it'll be on the screen too. We're reading from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. It's the fifth chapter. We'll read verses 8 through 15 this morning. Hear now the Word of God. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord Jesus Christ. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For it is light that makes everything visible. That is why it is said, wake up, O sleeper. Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. You may be seated. I was talking to Debbie and Gary before the service. And I was telling them about several Sundays ago, I came to church and sat down and was reading my bulletin. And it said we were going to sing "This Little Light of Mine." And I was, man, that's great. I love that song. And then when we stood up to sing the song, I remembered what I had to do every time we sang that song in my churches. You have to change the tune and you have to change the words, because those aren't the words I was raised on that we have in the hymnal. And thank God that Gary's a Jewel and Debbie, they're one step ahead of me. I wanted to change it and they'd already had it changed. And our ending song is "This Little Light of Mine" after the sermon. And we're going to sing it, I guess, the old way. Well, "This Little Light of Mine," we're going to let it shine. Remember that? Put it under, hide it under a bushel of water. I'm going to let it shine. Won't let Satan. I'm going to let it shine. That's how we're going to sing it. But more than sing it, folks, that's what we're supposed to be doing, isn't it? Letting our light of faith shine in this dark world, so that it might bring the light of Jesus into the lives of others, that they might know the love of God that we find only in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. As I thought about that, I thought about my own self and sort of had to do an evaluation of, what's the status of my light? And I want you to think about the status of your light this morning. Is your light of faith this morning shining bright, so that it is driving out the darkness of an evil world? Is it shining bright? For some of us, our light of faith might have grown a little dim as we've experienced life and sometimes been beaten down by life, or experienced the tragedy of a storm that we experienced this past week. And for some of us, our light might be flickering, a little fragile. How is your light this morning? For once you were darkness, says Paul, but now you're light in the world. And then Paul's admonition is, live as children of what? Light. Light. The Taylor crew grew up in the country. And gosh, when I was a kid, there weren't many houses on that road, was there? And the other thing was, we didn't have any sidewalks. I remember when our road was just dirt. Remember that, Robert?
There were six houses.
Okay, it wasn't many. There were no sidewalks and there were no street lights. And when it got dark in the country, well, Robert, it got pitch dark, didn't it? I was so thankful, folks, that by the time I came along, Columbus and Edith had electricity in that house. Because electricity has to be one of the greatest inventions in the world, y'all. You flip that switch and, wow, darkness dissipates, doesn't it? Darkness is gone because the light comes and floods out the darkness there is. Thank God for electricity. Huh? Yeah, and as long as you don't have a storm. How many times have you gone in and when your light's out, you went to that switch out of heaven and no light? But when that switch brings light, it's wonderful, isn't it? The darkness dissipates. Do you understand that's what you and I are to be in this world of ours? Light that dissipates the darkness of sin and evil, that helps bring in the love of God into the lives of people. We're to be light, says Paul. We're to live as children of light. This little light of mine, what? I'm shine. Shine is to shine. And why is it to shine? So that others may be drawn to it, so that darkness may dissipate, and goodness and truth and righteousness may come into this world of ours. There's a saying that we have that I think illustrates what I'm trying to say. You know it about you got to what? Not only talk the talk, but what? Ooh, yeah. Talk the talk, but you gotta walk the walk. In this postmodern world of ours, there seems to be a disconnect between the two, the talk and the walk. They don't seem to match up. Allison Thomas points this out in a book called Beyond the Pen, Living the Faith We Defend. She says this, and I quote her, "We tell young people to be financially responsible, but then we drown our own selves in debt. We say that character is more important than good looks, but we abuse our bodies in order to stay in shape and to be beautiful. We suggest that teens should not view pornography, and we label it adult as if it's perfectly legitimate for adults to be involved in." End of quote. I think her words point out a disconnect that happens sometimes between our talk and our this little light of mine, I'm going to want
let it shine.
Let it shine. Let it shine. You see, without walking the faith, talking the faith just becomes empty words and phrases and meaningless. Talk and walk must be connected and consistent. Back when they were together, D.C. Thomas, a contemporary Christian group that had a big hit called Jesus Freak. But on the album that they included that song on, before that song, they had this little statement that always hit me hard when I would listen to that album. This is what they said before they sang the song Jesus Free. I quote, "The greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians." Huh? "Who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, then walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle." That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. End of quote. If you're talking, you gotta do what? You gotta walk it. If you're talking, you gotta walk it. If not, your light is not shining bright. Your light is not dissipating the darkness. Your light is not bringing the love and mercy, forgiveness, and the grace of God into the lives of others. And I do believe that our world is in need of genuine Christian living with walk and talk together. Our world wants to see that our words and our actions align with one another. That what we talk about, we live out in our lives. That there is continuity between words and actions, talk and walk, between beliefs and practices. For once you were darkness, but now you are light in the world. Live as children of light. I'm going to let my light, what? Shine. Shine, shine, shine. Paul says that our light shines when we produce the fruit of the light. When we produce fruit of the light, And for him, there are three fruits of the light: goodness, righteousness, and truth. The first fruit, he says, is goodness, kindness. In other words, we are to be compassionate and caring and loving and helpful and generous. Our light shines when people see goodness and kindness and compassion in us toward others. Jesus calls his parable what Samaritan? The what Samaritan? The good Samaritan. Because it was the Samaritan who showed kindness and compassion and love and mercy and grace. One scholar says that what Paul is saying is that we are to treat all people as if they were our kinfolk, as if they were our own family. We are family in Christ, brothers and sisters. This is the family of God that is gathered this morning. Let it be a family of God when we go out into the world to live and work and play, so that others may see Jesus in us. A frequent question I would ask my people at Main Street would be, where have you seen Jesus this week? Where have you seen Jesus this week? Have you seen Jesus this week? Big time. Amen. If you're watching the TV, if you've been out, Jesus has been all over the place this weekend. Because people have been being light. And we as Christians have a great opportunity to let our light shine on our fellow South Carolinians as we seek to show compassion, as we seek to help them recover and rebuild from this devastating storm that has wrecked our area. Our light can shine bright in this situation. This little light of mine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. The second fruit, Paul says, that light must produce is righteousness. I believe he's talking about right living, holy living, moral, ethical living. You know, my family, John Wesley, says that we are beneficiaries of three graces of God. Well, or more than that, but he defined three. The prevenient graces at work in our life before we ever know it that helps bring us to God through Jesus Christ. And then that wonderful justifying grace that sets us right with God through Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And then, he says, there's also then what he calls sanctifying grace. That's the grace of God at work in our life to help us live out faith daily, to have right living, righteous living. You see, salvation is not the end of the journey, folks. And one of my favorite sayings is, I see too many people who get saved and then sit down on their grace and don't go any further. What a tragedy. Salvation is just the beginning. As followers of Christ, we're called to live out the gospel, to live out this faith of ours. And I'm making a confession this morning. It is so much easier to preach these sermons than it is to live them out. I found that to be true. It's easy to get up here and pontificate and say all these words. But buddy, when the rubber hits the road, it's a little bit different, isn't it? But that's what we're called to do. Talk it, walk it, live it. and we're not alone. We're not orphans. For Almighty God, through Jesus Christ, has given us the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit to undergird us and strengthen us, to help us live the life of faith. And finally, the last fruit Paul talks about is truth. Truth. Hard to come by sometimes, isn't it? Truth. When you got people putting their spin on things, and the truth somehow gets lost in the translation sometimes. The Greek word for truth implies sincerity, genuineness, the absence of sham or pretense. And Jesus said, why? You'll know the truth, and it'll what? The truth will make you free. Free. Truth is a byproduct of the light of Christ living in us and shining forth into the world. People know that we genuinely love God because we know Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. Once you were in darkness. But now the truth has come. You've been set free in Jesus Christ. And now, you're to let your light shine, shine, shine. Hide it under a bushel? No. I'm going to let it shine, shine, shine. Let Satan blow it out? No. I'm going to let it shine, shine. And that's your job and my job, to go out into this world of ours where there's darkness and sin and evil. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, all God's people say. Almighty gracious God, you've given us the light of the world. And you said in your word that darkness will never overcome it. Hallelujah. Let the light of Christ reside and live in us, and may it shine forth, O God, into this world of ours. That others may know the joy and the love that we have found in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And Father, we'll give you the praise and glory and honor now and forevermore. Amen and amen.
Thank you, Reverend Taylor, for those words. Generally, during the singing of this hymn right after the sermon, I invite you to come forward. I'm going to hold off on that until the last hymn. I just want you to have a chance to come forward and pray and have anointing with oil and those things. It sounds like this is going to be a little more interactive with the worship and all this stuff. So. It's all good. Unless you become like a child, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven. So I invite you to let your inner child come out and play on this one and enjoy this. And we've sing the song. If you haven't ever sung it before, if you're new to this, follow along with somebody next to you. This is, I'm coming home to something. I'm with Randy, and we sing that song sometimes. I'm like, that's not the right way to do it. So if we have a chance to do it the right way to do this. Enjoy it. Have fun. And like the last time, I'll invite you to come.
And all you have to do is learn, if you don't know it, learn those two lines. Hide it under a bushel? No.